This is the world record speedrun of Back for Blood's Act 1, Stockless on Recruited Difficulty. This will be a full explanation for the purposes of entertaining and educating. If you're interested in the speedrun without the post commentary, the link is in the description. Stockless category basically means I'm not allowed to use a gun with a stock attachment at any point in the speedrun. The version of the game I'm playing is 1.0. This is possible using a method called downpatching, which is a way to download previous versions of a game. The cleaner I'm running with is Carly Fincher, a young woman with purple hair, slicked back, and blue eyes. She benefits the team by sensing nearby hazards, increased use speed, and having an extra quick inventory slot. In the 1.0 version of the game, bots aren't randomized, so by playing as Carly, I always have Holly, Walker, and Evangelo on my team. Holly gives the team stamina, Evangelo brings the team movement speed, and Walker doesn't do shit. Holly and Evangelo are essential to completing the game as fast as possible. Carly starts off with an AK-47 and a Tech 9. The Tech 9 is a sidearm that is registered as a submachine gun. This gun provides a base movement speed of 441, which is the fastest movement speed for a gun while walking, not sprinting. The sprinting movement speed for all guns is 600. Speedrunning with a Tech 9 lets me swap the AK-47 for a much stronger primary weapon, allowing me to efficiently kill the boss, which I'll explain more shortly. There are two movement techniques used in Back 4 Blood speedruns: stamina hopping and bunny hop.
Come on.
A bunny hop is when I land a jump framed perfectly as I hit the ground, like this one here. This carries the momentum from one hop to another while regenerating some stamina. On the keyboard overlay, you can see that I'm pressing the spacebar button to jump as soon as I let go of my shift button, my spring key. This is how I stamina hop, and it's the movement technique that allows me to sprint jump without using up stamina. Stamina is the most important resource for speedrunning, and luckily, I bought a stamina upgrade earlier in this level.
Through there.
Tunnel of Blood has a neat glitch where I can trigger the game to think I'm inside the safe room by jumping against this wall. And to this day, it works on the current patch. The safe room door has an unlocking and locking animation. Therefore, I use the waiting time to check out what's for sale. I bought an offensive slot, and this will allow me to grenade two nest nodes from a distance in the levels Bad Seeds and Abandon. Pain Train has a swamp area with a movement speed penalty that slows me down. The reason why I have 5 seconds of possible time saved in this part is because I tried to land 8 bunny hops, only hitting one of them. Last time I gold split this level, I hit 3 out of 8 bunny hops. A crescendo event is the action involving a loud noise that attracts an onslaught of the devil worm infected. In patch 1.0, for most of the crescendo events, everyone alive on the team has to be gathered for it to begin. The second half of this level involves a crescendo event where I don't need the team. I have to wait 47 seconds for an invisible barrier to deactivate so I can jump over and sprint to the safe room. While I wait, I search for a better gun. Everything in this game is randomly generated. The RNG makes the game addicting and intense, but difficult to pull off the perfect speedrun. To grab a ledge and hop over it fast, like I do here, I have to jump and land into the grab. The game has a mechanic that after a jump, no matter how late, I can grab onto something if I get near it. This is one way I can also prevent fall damage. On the other hand, the slower ledge grab is when the object is higher than my eye level, hence the jump. I don't have much possible time save in the crossing. It's the first praise level on my life split, because the bots can take their sweet ass time crossing the bridge. Yeah, I'm talking about you, Walker. I spent a couple seconds shopping here for a potential upgrade and or an AA-12. Just in case I get stunned by a special, I purchase a stun gun. I then make sure I have a grenade on this level to blow up the liquefied petroleum gas tank from a distance. In hindsight, if I have an early offensive slot, I should have bought two grenades to prevent a hawker, crusher, or stalker from stunning my bots. I need the bots at the end to start the event and receive the explosive package. I've noticed the bots like to teleport when I'm going up the stairs, on the ferry, or next to this white box truck. To trigger the event, bots have to walk down this ramp. I found an AA-12 with a green uncommon magazine size, but I haven't picked it up yet. This tricks my brain into making sure I come back, allowing me to focus on the dangerous ferry skip. I get 1 minute to loot the ferry after planting the explosives, and I'll be looking for intel cards, weapons, attachments, and copper in the meantime. Intel cards are random cards located in various parts of each level. These cards can be found in a small white filing box. There are two types of intel cards. A free default card with a randomized stat and a pay to win additional card. I picked up the MP5 because the green uncommon version has 5 more move speed than the Tech 9. I'll leave a link in the description to a spreadsheet with all the weapon movement speed stats. Occasionally, there are special mutations that can stun me on the ferry. As Carly, I will not be able to break out of grabs because I dropped my stun gun for the explosive package. To be able to purchase 2 upgrades and all the equipment needed in the next level, I need at least 2300 copper. I don't have that much copper at this time, so if there are 2 good upgrades, I'm going to have to choose only one. I bought a blue rare ACOG attachment for my AA-12, a couple flashbangs, and luckily, another stamina upgrade. In my speedruns, I started to incorporate this novel jump in order to spawn kill the breaker boss. After a lot of attempts, I found out I can prevent the second round of common ridden from spawning, resulting in the breaker appearing a couple seconds earlier. I find a bear Uzi and I carry it to the garage. I then use it to skip the reload animation on my AA-12. I can kill the boss faster with a lucky card find like admin reload and epic attachments on my shotgun. Why did I choose the suppressor attachment over the magazine size for my AA-12, you ask? Simply because the breaker is unaware and idle for 5 seconds before his reveal animation. A review animation is the first action an infected does after being idle. Finish you off in peace. Over here. In your face. Got a feeling
this is Hope 1. We're setting up a triage location until we can extract the injured back to Hope. Rendezvous with the team at the library. Save as many as you can. God knows me.
I jump on this dumpster because if I put my back against the wooden part of the boarded up window, specials like Tallboy type and Reeker type will think I'm inside and path away from me. Plus, I can ping the same wall and the bots will rarely glitch, resulting in the rescuing of the survivor on the other side. before the gate opens. Throughout the speedrun, I can find pay-to-win intel cards and sometimes take a look to see what's for sale. If it helps me in completing the act faster, I purchase them. I purchase any card I haven't selected from my deck yet, or any offensive slot card, stamina card, and or stamina regen cards. I didn't get the lucky rescue and got hawked twice, losing both of my stun guns.
Feels bad.
At this time, I felt good about the speedrun and hoped not to get a breaker boss inside the library. That would have ended the run.
Try to keep up.
Boarding up this early window is good RNG, and in a little bit you'll see that I also get the window by the exit door.
So use whatever you have to. At the moment it's got more holes in it than Swiss cheese. Seal it up.
There's an odd thing I've seen in my speedruns on this level. When I go to the second floor at the exit door, sometimes I can see survivors exiting. I've only tried once to run out with them in hopes of skipping the windows task, but the door shut on me way too fast. How nice would it be if this game had more convoluted Easter eggs we didn't know about?
Now you're just shut in here with me. General,
I shoot this explosive barrel to get myself a lower HP for what's coming up next. The dead skip.
Any survivors? Over. No survivors. Over. I see.
I get the late ogre spawn and use his reveal animation to take some more damage.
I need you to get the apartments ASAP. Folks there in deep shit, we can't afford to lose any more fighters. Hope one out.
Come on.
With the bot healing me right here, I am not low enough to do the dead skip.
Haven't been able to restore communications. Search for survivors.
Luckily, I can use this stinger to prepare me for death. I remember my first attempt at it. I didn't get to complete the level because I was on patch 1.4 and quickly learned, yeah, it was patched. Barroom Blitz is coming up, which is the second Prage level on our life split. This level has 9 seconds of possible time saved using a glitch called the Fast Cycle. This is where I get 2 survivors loaded onto the bus rather than 1 initially. After many attempts to consistently trigger the Fast Cycle, I've managed to get this done back to back to back.
Don't worry about your patience. Let us
worry about the rhythm.
We can hold out the bar, have a drink, listen to tunes, and shoot some rhythm!
Finally, an order I can get behind.
Oh man! This is gonna be wild! And that's what you get!
Explosion time!
Watch my back!
I'm not certain, but I believe this glitch is time-based because I can't trigger the fast cycle on the main category. Move in the future. I did confirm it isn't the SFX because I've had the fast cycle happen with the SFX both on and off. I should look into this more because there are different voice lines the game says as I leave the safe room.
Don't see anyone else's name on it.
I'm going to leave links in the description of more in-depth videos on the discoveries of all the methods I mentioned in this speedrun. This round isn't as fun in recruited difficulty, mainly because in Nightmare, I have to be hyper aware of the jukebox, or else the onslaught of the devil worm infected will shut the music off, delaying the crescendo event. I want to go into the last 4 rounds with as much time saved as possible, because they're all RNG intensive.
Let's do this!
Molotov here!
After hitting the fast cycle, I must say this has to be my luckiest first half of a speedrun ever. This is the type of sauce I'm looking for in my Act 1 recruit main category. I'm going to need more practice to beat my lightweight stock personal best. Surprisingly, during the speedrun, I was feeling calm and relaxed until the very end. This was because I had gotten to abandon so many times just to have the run end because of a bot. Walker. We are near the halfway mark, and if you've made it this far, congratulations. I've been rambling this whole time, so thank you for following along.
Heads up!
Get back!
One more to go!
Watch out!
Need to reload!
Boy.
The Back for Blood speedruns go by real time, RTA. RTA means you time your speedruns using real world time. This includes loading screens, cutscenes, and everything else. This means your PC setup can have an impact on the speedrun time. For this speedrun, I have my game saved on my HDD and I'm using my 60Hz monitor with an average CPU on medium graphics settings. Inside the bar, I can sometimes find a toolkit that I can use to open the stash room for Intel cards. I've had a pay-to-win Intel card spawn before, but none of them have benefited me in completing the act faster yet. The reason I didn't save the extra time was because I am comparing it to another speedrun where I also got the fast cycle, and strangely, still saved a couple seconds. Third bridge level is special delivery, because the supply crates are RNG just like the nests and locked doors. I skipped the vendor here because it's a really short level. I sprint to the gate because I have to wait for the gate animation to open use this wait time to regenerate my stamina back.
We've lost contact with the supply team working on repairs.
I have 5 seconds of possible time saved in this round because of the RNG locations the supply crate can spawn in.
Still got all the meds locked up there?
The best supply crate spawn is behind the white box truck, and the worst supply crate spawn is inside the bathroom. With the flashlights laying on the floor, pointing directly towards the supply crates, I can find them pretty easily. In this run, I got one of the good RNG locations where I don't have to retrace as many steps. You've probably noticed I haven't shopped for a stun gun and still don't in the diner level. Having the extra offensive slot from earlier helps me skip the vendor. I just have to play more safely versus hawkers, sleepers, and crushers. I kill this crusher or else Walker gets grabbed. Bots getting stunned will prevent me from turning on the generator at the diner, killing the run. This is what makes the diner a prage level. It's an easy level where you can lose 5 to 10 seconds. This is another crescendo event, where the generator is attracting the common rhythm for 5 minutes. Unlike the barroom blitz jukebox, the generator doesn't take damage. I can AFK as long as I stay alive. For that reason, I use a God Spot. A God Spot is a location where most of the special mutations and common ridden can't hit me and can't path to me. There are about 7 different God Spots on this level, but the one I'm using is the safest one, especially against stinger type mutations.
Easier than you'd thunk.
I don't think that's what happened.
In Nightmare, I prefer to set up the razor wire to slow down the common ridden and use the minigun to kill tallboy type and Reeker type mutations. In patch 1.0, razor wire is an offensive accessory, so the offensive upgrades I buy throughout the act will affect them.
Big trouble once you get the bullets back in this gun.
Razor wire
Before I jump on the minigun and take a small break, I loot and prepare my shotgun for the upcoming nest nodes and special mutations that show up in the last four levels. We made it to the diner god spot, and in the meantime, I'll be explaining my speedrunning deck and pick order. Keep in mind, some of these cards have changed and are different on the current patch. Okay, let's begin. In Resurgence, I grab Run Like Hell and Mad Dash for 15% move speed and 20% sprint speed. I skipped Vendor in Resurgence because of three things. First of all, I can't purchase an upgrade with the starting gold. Second of all, I don't need the grenade until the next round. And lastly, the vendor isn't near the safe room door. In the level Tunnel of Blood, I grab Fleet of Foot, buy a grenade, and buy an upgrade if available. In this run, I luckily got a stamina upgrade. Speed Demon comes next in Pain Drain. This is the card that gives the submachine gun holder 6% extra movement speed. As mentioned earlier, the Tech 9 is categorized as an SMG. In the crossing, I choose On Your Mark. All the cards I've mentioned thus far are the main core selection in your speedrunning deck. From this point onward, the decks vary for different speedrunners. Over time, these cards have gone through some changes. The next card I pick up in Clean Sweep has been the same since the game was released, and for good reason. It's the Headbang Magnifier. This has the highest amount of use speed a cleaner can get from a single card. For Bookworms, I pick Hellfire. It comes in handy because there is a lot of shooting while moving. Hellfire has a 45% move speed while firing, plus 5% move speed while not. In Barroom Blitz, I choose Dash for an additional 5% move speed. For Special Delivery, I choose Cross Trainers. This is the last card on the list that gives movement speed. In 1.0, this card has a glitch that gives 40% more stamina regen than the 20% intended. At the start of this level, the diner, I picked Olympic Sprinter. The order in which you select this and the next card doesn't matter, mainly because I have my stamina upgraded and the diner is a small map to traverse. Next level is Bad Seeds. I'm going to pick Superior Cardio for 20% stamina and 20% sprint efficiency. After that, in Hell's Bells, I'm going to choose Multi-Tool to help speed up the bordering of the windows. For the level Abandoned, we cover the most ground in the whole act, so I grab Rhythmic Breathing for the increased stamina. For the final level, the Sound of Thunder, I get Screwdriver for the use speed to load up the howitzer quicker. My 15th card is Reckless. I have this card in the deck just in case I find a pay to win intel card I've already mentioned in my speedrun deck. I'll leave a link in the description to a spreadsheet with the suggested optimal decks for all the acts from the speedrunning website. The AA-12 I currently have has the optimal type of attachments: laser sight, bullet damage, and ACOG or high zoom scope. With these attachments, I've got the breaker down to a couple hits before he destroys the garage door in the level Clean Sweep. I'm curious if I can softlock the game by killing him too early. My Tech 9 has no attachments. Ideally, I'd prefer a magazine size and a compensator for the speedrun. I'm stretching my legs during this break and planning out the level Abandoned. I feel comfortable with Bad Seeds and Hell's Bells, and I'll explain why in a little bit. I played the last four rounds with a stun gun, so the first thing I do in Bad Seeds is buy a couple of those.
Been showing up in increasing numbers around 50.
I unfortunately messed up my personal best life splits and need to clear the history for this level. The actual possible time saved on this level is 5 seconds, not 15.
last transmission we received from them was that they were approaching the mine but facing heavy opposition.
Why them and not us?
Luckily, I got the best starting RNG nest node. For the next nest node, I used a grenade, but I did have to spend a couple seconds running to the final one. It's still faster than the nest node behind the house, so I can't complain. What I could have done in this situation is sprinted to the first nest node and shot it down, then used my two grenades to blow up the remaining nests from a distance. The level Hell's Bells is coming up. When I was speedrunning Nightmare, I reviewed this level and the next level with careful scrutiny. I was having trouble with two things. One was getting the bots to the crescendo event. The other was getting destroyed by special mutations while boarding up the windows at the church. I have zero time saved because on my personal best, I gold split. If I play it the same way, I should match it, right? Walker, right? In Hell's Bells, I buy safety grenades just in case there's a hawker, crusher, or a stalker in the tunnel. I also bought another lucky offensive slot upgrade. I got lucky, and there aren't any special mutations in the tunnel. After playing this many times over and over again, just like in the crossing, the bots teleport to the semi-truck first, then jump down. If I run ahead of them, they get stuck at the semi-truck, ending the run. Just like my personal best, I got the instant button press. But it's not over yet. I still have the RNG windows to board up. In my personal best run, I had the best window setup. I know for sure, if I get a bad setup here, I'm going from green to red on my life split. What I can do while waiting for the trailer is find some grenades or an extra intel card. I don't need any equipment, so I just run to the church, and I'm already planning on not using the vendor next round.
Well, this is new.
I mean, it's not like me to be nervous, but that heckle's raising on my heckles.
I think you meant hackles. Jesus, is there a non-creepy trail?
Yeah, this is it.
Get to the church. We can hold
them. Yeah.
I saved a few milliseconds preemptively casting the safe room door animation. I'm careful to not open this door before the check mark for the trailer task. Otherwise, the game will softlock and prevent me from completing the level. The bots have been in their best behavior so far. Look how they're following right behind me. On top of that, when I needed them the most, they listened to my pings. This is extremely rare because pinging the bots to come to me is far from consistent. Abandoned is the level where most of my world record pace speedruns would end, and I'm always blaming Walker for it. Well, with the mistake I made in Abandoned, Walker is the real MVP of this world record speedrun.
I got your back.
After exiting the safe room, there is a shack up ahead that will occasionally have locked doors.
I heard something.
Up intel that the mines could be some sort of lair.
Why would anyone want to live out in the middle of nowhere?
Unfortunately, I waste my first grenade throw on a nest that wasn't there. However, I don't panic and break my flow state. I adjust to the situation. I want the bots to be as close to the final nest as possible. In order to do this, I position myself at the final nest and use my last two grenades to blow up the last two nests.
Damn.
I make sure it's clear of special mutations before I jump here. Thankfully, the bots gather up quickly and I can start the crescendo event. Aside from losing time destroying the nest nodes, this was my luckiest stockless speedrun ever. But it's not over yet. In the last level, the Sound of Thunder, the bots can still take their sweet ass time to gather at the howitzer.
Got a feeling things are gonna get ugly. Get some light here. Let's go.
Use the field gun and take out that mine. And make sure you bring my vehicle back. We can't afford to waste any more resources.
Let's hope Pelisaro's fleet is in us.
Hey, everyone! You just finished the job.
If you're interested, here are my nightmare world record speedruns for Act 1. I had so much fun making this video, and I would like to thank you all for watching.